Hello friends, welcome to Smart Catalyst. Today we'll be seeing the current affairs of 15th November 2018. Before getting into today's analysis, we have got few queries regarding the procedure to download the PDF we have attached. So we'll address the issue now. So in the description of the video, there'll be a link for the PDF. Click the link. The link will lead you to another window of Smart Leaders IAS website. So in the website of Smart Leaders IAS, if you are a new user, you have to register. And if you have already registered, type in your ID and password and log in. After logging in, you will be redirected to the downloads page of Smart Leaders IAS Academy. Here, all the PDFs are listed date-wise. Click the desired date. So the PDF will also have MCQs attached in each of them. So coming back to today's news analysis, the topics we'll be seeing for prelims are these six. First one is about the new satellite launched by ISRO called as GSAT-29. Second one is about Iran and India's tall ship sail together program. Third one is about Bhumi Rashi portal. Fourth article is about National Council on India's nutrition challenge. The fifth article will be talking about new scheme to promote young entrepreneurs within cooperatives of India. And the final article will be seeing the 15th Finance Commission suggestion with respect to disaster management in India. The first article we'll be seeing is ISRO's GSAT-29 launch, a gained leap towards manned space mission in 2021. So this article was taken from the newspaper Indian Express. So here the news is that GSAT-29, a communication satellite of ISRO, was recently launched into space using GSLV Mark III vehicle. So here for the prelims, one needs to know what is GSLV Mark III vehicle as well as GSAT-29 satellite. So GSLV Mark III launch vehicle is a three-stage heavyweight launcher. So this vehicle was indigenously developed by ISRO, and the vehicle has three stages. The first stage is a solid stage, second one is a core liquid booster, and the third stage is an indigenously designed cryogenic stage. So this cryogenic stage has been designed by ISRO in order to increase the efficiency of the propellants, thus increasing the specific impulse for the rocket propulsion. So this GSLV Mark III vehicle can carry up to 4000 kgs of satellite into geosynchronous transfer orbit and till 10,000 kg of satellite into low Earth orbit. And this Mark III has a capacity of almost twice that of its earlier predecessors. So now let's see about GSAT-29. So GSAT-29 is a multi-beam communication satellite. So it has multiple transponders which will provide communication links to remote areas in the country. So this satellite has been exclusively designed to increase the communication services, especially to northeastern part of India and the Jammu Kashmir, which are ideally neglected from the communication services till this date. So indirectly, this satellite will help increase India's Digital India initiative and thus increase the digital penetration in India. And another important usage of this satellite is to be used to ISRO's second moon man mission, that is Chandrayaan-2, which is scheduled to be implemented next year. So next article we'll be seeing is Retracing Asian Maritime Trade Route, Tall Ship Sail Together Program. So this article was taken from PIB. So this Tall Ship Sail Together program is a program between Iran and India. So this event was organized by Indian Navy as a part of celebration of 10th anniversary of Indian Ocean Naval Symposium. So in order to commemorate this, delegates from about 26 countries attended this event. The main purpose of this event is to retrace the Asian maritime trade route between Malabar coast and the Persian Gulf. So this exercise was inaugurated from the coastal city of Kerala. So this is to commemorate the legendary role played by this maritime hub in the ancient trade route between Iran and India. Kerala was legendary maritime hub way back in 1st century AD. And Kerala also had an intense shipbuilding facility way back then. And iconic ships which were built in this facility were called as Urus. And from Kerala, the maritime trade between India and Iran continued over for 1500 years. So this memories of glorious maritime past and the cultural exchange between India and those in Persia and Arabia has now resulted in long distance relationship in political as well as economic spheres between India and Iran. The third article we'll be seeing is Bhumi Rashi Portal. So this Bhumi Rashi portal was inaugurated under Ministry of Road, Transport and Highways in order to increase the efficiency of land acquisition in case of roadways and highways in India. This portal, by using technology, it aims to make the land acquisition process totally digital and paperless, thus reducing the processing time as well as making the whole process environment friendly. The process also will become transparent, quick, as well as corruption-free because of using digital technology. Real-time tracking of activities with respect to land acquisition will be made available via this portal, and also generation of report has resulted in reduce the time taken in the whole process. To put together, these facilities will improve India's ease of doing business ranking. So next article we'll be seeing is National Council on India's Nutrition Challenges. So this article was also taken from PIB. The third meeting of National Council of India's Nutrition Challenges happened recently. So in this perspective, one needs to know what this council is about. So this National Council on India's Nutrition Challenges is headed by the Vice Chairman of Niti Aayog. The council was constituted in order to provide easy policy directions and thus to address the nutrition challenges existing in our country. In order to address these challenges, it ensures that there is effective cooperation as well as convergence between various ministries with respect to various nutrition challenges in India. The council is also tasked with various review programs on quarterly basis. The third meeting, which happened recently, focused on the efforts by Ministry of Women and Child Development as well as efforts from Ministry of Health. The aim of the meeting was to make India malnutrition free and thus providing more focus on providing nutritious food to children as well as beneficiaries from low socio-economic strata. The meeting also gave special importance to the scheme of Poshan Abhiyan. So this Poshan Abhiyan, it aims to bring in a positive behavioral change towards the perception of infants and young children's feeding practices which are presently practiced in India. The mission emphasized on importance of breastfeeding and the positive effects it will have on the health of a child. So next article we'll be seeing is new scheme to promote young entrepreneurs in cooperatives. So the Union Minister of Agriculture recently launched NCDC's new scheme to promote young entrepreneurs in cooperatives. So what is this NCDC? So NCDC stands for National Cooperatives Development Corporation. So let's see a bit more about NCDC. So this NCDC is a financial institution in order to develop the cooperative sector in India. So it is a statutory organization which functions as a financial as well as development institutions exclusively devoted to increase the cooperative sector penetration in India. So its areas of efforts are pretty diverse. It includes from agricultural sector to its elite fields. So the new scheme launched under NCDC is called as Yuva Sahakar. So it is a cooperative enterprise and support innovation scheme in order to attract youths into cooperative business ventures. By encouraging youths to participate in cooperatives, this scheme aims to introduce new innovative innovations in cooperative sector area. So there is also another initiative called as Sahakar 22 under NCDC. So this initiative, by using the tool of cooperatives in agricultural sector, it aims to double the farmers' income by 2022. And in order to aid these two initiatives, NCDC has also created a CSIF fund, Cooperative Startup and Innovation Fund, with a corpus of 1000 crores. So this CSIF fund is specially created to provide special incentives for cooperatives, especially in underdeveloped regions of northeastern states, to districts under Aspirational Districts Program of India. And special incentives will be also be provided to the cooperatives headed by women, scheduled caste, scheduled tribe and physically disabled members. In order to provide inclusion, these categories of people will be provided up to 80% of the project cost as against 70% for others. The next article we'll be seeing is 15th Finance Commission and its recommendation towards disaster risk reduction in India. So in the recently concluded 15th Finance Commission's International Workshop on Disaster Risk Management, it laid special emphasis on the change in the perception towards disaster policies. So this is because 15th Finance Commission has been mandated under terms of reference to review the disaster policies that are currently prevailing in India. So in order to exercise that, the 15th Finance Commission has recently conducted an international workshop on disaster risk management. And we'll see the important key points now. The first key point is disaster risk management in India must include areas ranging from urbanization, climate change, coastal erosion, as well as localized catastrophes. The workshop also focused on the need for creating a new disaster mitigation fund. It also provided the ways and means to collect those funds from both tax as well as non-tax resources. The workshop also spoke about the sources of fund. So the sources for fund can come from Finance Commission devolution, National Disaster Response Force as well as State Disaster Response Force Fund, crowdsourcing of money, corporate social responsibility as well as funds from other multilateral institutions. The workshop also spoke about effective utilization of this fund, especially in mitigation as well as relief activities with respect to various disasters in India. The workshop also emphasized the importance of federalism. And federalism can be used as a tool to strengthen the horizontal exchange of resources as well as expertise between different states, especially during the timely situation of disasters. The 15th Finance Commission, whose major role is to suggest rules for fund devolution between state and the center, is planning to use a concept called as Risk Index of States of UNDP in order to guide the resource allocation between the states and center with respect to disaster fund allocation. So as a rapidly urbanizing nation in the path of development, India definitely needs to take into consideration of the factor of disasters and mitigate them in order to attain sustainable development and also to achieve the goals of sustainable development. So the topics for mains are these five. The first one will be seeing about the new SEBI regulations with respect to credit rating agencies industry in India. The second one talks about setting a proper diet plan and nutrition status in India. The third article is about the right policy mix for conservation of wildlife in India. So the fourth article is about the deferment of RCEP deal to the year of 2019. And the final article is about Supreme Court recent verdict on fake killings. The first article we'll be seeing is full disclosure on the credit rating industry. So this article was taken from the newspaper Hindu. So SEBI, that is Security and Exchange Board of India, has increased the level of scrutiny with respect to the credit rating agencies, especially after the IL and FS crisis. The need for new guidelines is because the credit rating agencies which are presently existing in India have failed to warn the investors about the crisis which was about to come. So what is the purpose of credit rating agencies? So ideally, a credit rating agency's main function is to inform the investors about the liquidity situation in India. These credit rating agencies, they assess the liquidity in the economy based on few parameters. Those parameters include cash balance, liquidity coverage ratio, access to emergency credit lines, asset liability mismatch, etc. And also another point to note is that these credit rating agencies, they will also have to disclose their own historical track record. That is how accurate their rating has been in the recent past with respect to warning the investors. So SEBI has brought in the recent guidelines. So this recent guidelines is a continuation of its earlier guidelines issued for credit rating agencies in the year 2016. So in this guidelines aims to bring in transparency, credibility of the credit rating agencies. However, the major problems existing with respect to the credit rating agencies industry in India is with respect to the structural changes which are inherently present in them. The first main problem is the flawed issuer pays model. So here, normally the bond issuing agencies, they pay the credit raters in order to rate the bonds issued by them. So this creates a conflict of interest situation. Thus eroding the efficiency of information available to the investors based on which they decide the area of their investment. So the Government of India has set high barriers for the entry of agencies into credit rating industries. So this has led to lack of competition, which in turn has led to a situation of oligopoly. So what is the way forward out of this problem? So first is increase the competition. So for increasing the competition, alternative credit rating agency providers needs to be available. Only if there is competition, quality standards will be ensured. Structural reform should be made available in order to end the loyalty of the credit rating agencies to the bond issuers. So for such a change, the policy framework must concentrate on the interest of investors rather than the interest of the borrowers alone. And a policy framework which concentrates on easy entry as well as innovative framework for credit rating agencies is also imperative here. The next article we'll be seeing is setting a proper diet plan. So this article was also taken from the paper Hindu, and this article emphasizes on the importance of nutrition in India. So the article starts with providing few empirical data. So India has been ranked at the position of 103 out of 119 countries by Global Hunger Index, which is released by International Food Policy Research Institute. So this institute takes into consideration four indicators to assess a country. The indicators are inadequate food supply, under 5 child mortality, and child undernutrition, which has two parameters, child wasting as well as child stunting. So this index has categorized India under serious category. So another data provided in the article is National Family Health Survey 2016 data. According to that, the proportion of stunted children in India is very high when compared to global average, as well as the proportion of underweight children is also very high when compared to global average. So all these facts show that the increasing economic development as well as the growing prosperity due to economic development do not have any positive impact on chronic malnutrition of children prevailing in India. So let's assess this situation based on two important parameters. Number one is economic growth versus hunger, and number two is agriculture versus hunger. So India has been registering a faster economic growth for past few years, but this economic growth has not efficiently translated into good health of children in India. So this lack of nutrition not just affects the health of children, but it also affects their educational parameter, wages, as well as productivity. That is, the human capital is affected. So this economic growth versus hunger problem has created this new type of inequality called as dietary inequality. So let's analyze this inequality with an example. Take into consideration a state like Odisha, which is a part of Empowerment Action Group state. Those are the 8 states which are socio-economically backward in India. And take into consideration another state like Gujarat or Maharashtra, which are considered as developed states. So ideally, the developed states must perform well in nutrition parameters because of their high economic growth. However, states like Odisha, with their implementation of special schemes like public health schemes, as well as improved education of women has translated into better nutrition status of children as well as women in the state. However, the developed state lag behind in the nutritional parameters. So this shows the inequality existing with respect to economic growth as well as hunger. The second dimension is agriculture versus hunger. Ideally, agriculturally dominant states must have good nutrition status. However, it is seen that malnutrition continues to exist, especially in higher levels in agriculturally surplus states like Haryana. The states which are agriculturally backwards like Odisha, they perform well when compared to Haryana, which has high stunting as well as underweight children. So what are the solutions to address these problems? The first solution can be brought in by increasing the diversity of food available. So this diversity of food is measured by using an index called as Food Intake Index. And this index covers 19 food items across 640 districts in India. And this index can be used as an ideal scale to measure malnutrition in India. Using this scale, it is observed that more the diversity of food intake, lesser is child stunting. They make sense. Important statistics according to this index is there are only 12% of stunted children in areas where there is diversity of food available, whereas in other areas the number of stunted children are are exponentially high. Second change which needs to be brought in is to bring in inclusive and holistic approach in order to regulate food prices. So this can be regulated by bringing in food articles under public distribution system as well as by providing income support policies for the food items. In order to cover the food expenses, income support policies are required, especially for economically weaker sections. The next change can be brought in via various welfare policies. For example, take into consideration the policy of integrated child development services. So take into consideration the scheme of integrated child development. So this scheme, which was inaugurated in the year 1975, it provides special health and educational facilities for primary school children, as well as food for children below the age of 6, as well as their mothers. So this scheme can be extended to secondary as well as tertiary group in India in order to address the issue of malnutrition. So India has recently launched a National Nutrition Mission in order to tackle the problem of nutrition. So this is a right and welcome step to address and fight the maternal as well as malnutrition in India. So achieving the target set under the National Nutrition Mission is a right step in order to curtail the problem of malnutrition in India. The next article we'll be seeing is right policy mix for conservation efforts. So recently a tiger called as Avni was shot dead in the state of Maharashtra, and this indicates the extent of human wildlife conflict existing in India. The wildlife conservation policies which are currently present in India are poorly designed. According to these policies, they make humans as the victims of conservation effort, and this victimization is clearly evident, especially in case of the tribal population. So this tribal population, who solely depend on the forest for their day-to-day activities, are extensively affected by these poor policies. For example, take into consideration the Wildlife Protection Act of 1972. This act created human-free zones in order to protect the endangered species in India. However, this act failed to recognize the role of tribes in the protection of wildlife in India. So this act is a clear manifestation of the exclusionist policy followed by the government of India. However, though the Wildlife Protection Act follows an exclusionary approach, there is yet another act called as Forest Right Act, which includes the role of tribals played in maintaining the ecological stability in India. So this Forest Rights Act of 2006, which recognized the role of tribals, is also supported in the recently released National Wildlife Action Plan of 2017 and 2031, which also utilizes the local population in order to support the conservation in India. So ideally, environmental extremism is considered to be an impediment to the economic development of a country. So however, in India, environmental extremism, which was manifested via conducting environmental impact assessment as just become a rubber stamp rather than showing any positive effects on eliminating the human-wildlife conflict in India. The 1991 budget, which brought in the landmark changes of LPG into India, also spoke about the importance of maintaining balance between environment and development. However, India has not yet achieved the right trade-off between environment and development, and it is a right time to bring in proper regulation as well as policy to reflect this realization. The next article we'll be seeing is India can breathe easy for now as RCEP deal deferred for 2019. Yesterday RCEP's second ministerial meeting was concluded in Singapore, and in this meeting it was concluded that the RCEP has been deferred. So in this context, one needs to know what is RCEP about. So RCEP is Regional Comprehensive Economic Partnership, ASEAN nations, which includes 10 Southeast Asian countries as well as plus 6 nations in Asia Pacific region. So the main 7 pillars of RCEP meeting is economic and technical cooperation, small and medium scale enterprises, customary procedures dealing trade facilitation, governmental procurement, institutional provisions, standards, technical regulations, as well as conformity assessment procedures, as well as sanitary and phytosanitary measures. The points 6 and 7 are the major areas of concern in the ongoing negotiations. In August ministerial conference of RCEP, the trade ministers of the different member countries of RCEP, they resolved to conclude this RCEP by end of December. However, there are several points of negotiation which has prevented the conclusion of the meet by now. This is because several member states head for election this year, as well as several market access issues also remain unsolved. However, negotiations will continue to happen in areas of e-commerce as well as competition and investment chapters, along with addressing the areas of concern in these areas. The guiding principles and objectives of negotiating RCEP, they emphasize the importance of market access. And the negotiations involving market access have been given special consideration as it has potential to expand and also deepen the supply chains between the 16 RCEP nations. However, there are some areas of contention for India. Number first factor is the factor of China. We all know India has extensive trade deficit with respect to China, and by signing RCEP, there will be greater market access to Chinese goods in India, which will definitely affect the regional marketing sectors, mainly in sectors of steel and textiles. Other than China, increasing the market access among non-free trade agreement partners like Australia and New Zealand will also affect India's indigenous industries. So another area of concern for India is bringing in a balanced outcome with respect to dispute resolution mechanisms of RCEP. The final article we'll be discussing is fake killings, Supreme Court verdict leaves army red-faced. So there was a bill filed in Supreme Court by Extrajudicial Execution Victim Association of Manipur and Impal-based Human Rights Alert, alleging that about 1,500 extrajudicial killings have occurred between the years 1980 and 2011, which were committed by Indian Army and various other paramilitary forces like Assam Rifles, Central Paramilitary Force, as well as Manipur Police. In the hearing of the case, Army pleaded for recusal by the bench of Supreme Court. However, the Supreme Court has dismissed such a plea. So it is to be noted that Army and paramilitary forces, they come under the regulation of AFSPA Act. However, Manipur Police, they do not come under the purview of the AFSPA Act of 1958. So in order to deal with this situation, the Supreme Court is directed to segregate the investigation and judicial process of the paramilitary forces and the Manipur Police separately. So Indian Army views this area as a threat to its position in India. And if in case Supreme Court goes forward and dilutes AFSPA citing human rights violation, this may lead to increased threat to national security, according to Indian Army. So in order to move forward, the government must consider the recommendation provided by Justice Jeevan Reddy Committee as a way forward. Thank you.